Okay, thank you. Thank you for the organizers for inviting me to this excellent summer school on a wonderful location. And I will talk mostly today about our recent observation of Bose-Einstein condensation in a plasmonic system, a plasmonic lattice. And to put this into context, you know that there are many kind of condensates and superfluids in the nature, starting from helium superfluids only almost 100 years ago. And then there are these famous condensates of ultragold atoms, and one can see also condensation of quasi-particles like magnons. And then there are, of course, application superconductors, which also can be understood as Bose condensates, are really important. And then there are this type of more photonic condensates. And now we have introduced a new member to this big family. And if you look at who are the closest cousins of our condensates, they are these other luminous condensates. So polariton condensates are based on having this hybrids of cavity photons and semiconductor excitons, which we already talked about many times in this conference, in this summer school. And there is a lot of work done on those systems when they go to the quantum degeneracy and condense. And then there are also photon condensates. So here this is in the weak coupling. The photons don't hybridize with matter, but yet they condense. And then ours is related to this, maybe perhaps a bit more related to these photon condensates. But we in our system, we can also achieve a regime that is similar to polariton condensates, although we have not explored it yet. Okay, but before going to the actual topic, I will give quite a long background and tell about some other work we have done. So I have been interested for quite some years in plasmonic lattices. So my motivation is that we can create lattice systems, so we can play with the geometry, density of states, and so on. But we can do things in very small scale, like in the whole lattice can be small, and in particular the nanoparticles that the lattice is composed of, they can be very small. So this is a 100 nanometer scale picture of a lattice of metal nanoparticles on glass. And because these are small and they are metallic, you have plasmonic resonances. This means that everything becomes very fast. So dynamics is fast in these systems. And also because of the properties of the system, you can do things at higher temperatures than in some other systems. And these are on-chip systems, hopefully can lead to applications. So one more interesting thing about this system is that strong coupling can be reached quite easily in plasmonic systems in general, and also in these systems, as has been shown by many works. And now you see our system is periodic, so it actually does have something like a band structure. This is an experiment showing it. And you can calculate the effective mass in this band structure, and it's very, very small. And from there you can make an estimate when could it condense. And the estimate was that it could condense in room temperature, and this has been my goal for many years, and now we have seen it. So then I explain you in detail what are these plasmonic lattices, and if you haven't yet learned what is the plasmonic resonance in a nanoparticle, you can now learn it, although it has been said many times. So basically, when we have small nanoparticles and impose radiation on them, let's say the polarization is in this direction, you will induce free electron motion in the particle. But there is also a restoring force inside the particle coming from the Coulomb interaction between electrons and holes. And this tries to pull them together. And this means that you can create a resonance. So these particles have resonances where they like to absorb light very much and also emit light like little antennas. And you have around this resonance, you have very high near fields around them, and they radiate quite nicely. And this has been applied already for a long time, because depending on the size, this resonance is at different color. So you can use nanoparticles of different size to create colors. And here you see this effect very nicely in a very simple experiment, where there are nanoparticles which are different lengths but the same width. And now if you illuminate them with light that is polarized along this direction, so that the electron motion is in this direction, then these have different sizes and consequently have different colors. Not so visible on the screen, but this is different color from this, as you see. And then if you turn the polarization and now all particles just oscillate in the short direction, then the color is the same. And also it depends on the size, but also on the shape of the material. Okay, so what follows if you now put many of these particles in your system? And quite obviously, if you arrange them so that they are separated from each other by about the wavelength of the resonant light, you expect that there might be some kind of interference effects going on. Because these are like little antennas, they radiate in this direction when you drive them with this polarization. And indeed, there are new modes that appear in this lattice. And now, if you have a periodic structure of basically anything, this could be now dielectric or whatever, doesn't need to be metal, it has some diffracted orders, as you see here, following this equation. And now what we are interested is in this in-plane diffracted order. So that would be in a periodic system. But now in our periodic system, the particles that sit on these sides, they also have a strong resonance of their own. And now these resonances and the diffracted orders hybridize, they form together a new mode, and this is called surface lattice resonance. So the character of this mode is that it's largely light, because the diffracted order, light feeling it in a diffracted order would be just light. But since it contains also the single particle resonance, it partly contains this electron plasma oscillation that take place in the metal. So that's the kind of hybrid that we can create in these systems. And then it can have a dispersion, because you can think that this mode also may have in-plane momentum, and you can excite such a case by exciting with an angle, so you give some in-plane momentum, and you see that the diffraction condition is then different, so that with higher k corresponds to also higher energy, or lower, different energy than this, so you get dispersion. And here you see how the absorption spectrum may look like. So the single nanoparticle resonance is typically very broad, as you could see here, and now when it hybridizes with the diffracted order, which is very narrow, you will get a funnel-shaped resonance. That's typical when you combine a broad and narrow resonance, you get the funnel shape. And this is what you hear. So this is the mode of interest. And then, yes, we can also measure the dispersion. So this is these are transmission picture experiments. And this k vector is now the k vector in plane, in one of the directions in plane. And you see that indeed you have the features in transmission as a function of a k, which at the gamma point when momentum is zero, they show a small band gap. So here you have like a band bottom to the SLR mode. Small band gap here, you don't see anything because the mode here is dark. This one is bright. And that's something that we will utilize for the Bose-Einstein condensate, because in a condensation you have to you want to find a lowest energy value where all the particles go. So in our case, it is this one. And that sort of comes from the properties of the plasmonic resonance, because if you would have only the diffracted orders, they would cross like this. But the resonance helps to scatter wave that comes this way on the plane very efficiently on this type of wave going to the other direction, and this creates a sizable gap. So, as a reminder, this is what we are trying to condense modes following this dispersion. But before going to that, let me show a little bit of work that we and others have done already with these systems. So, we can bring these systems to the strong coupling regime of light and matter. And matter that we put on the top of the array is now dye molecules in a polymer in this experiment. So then these surface lattice modes may couple with the molecular excitations, and we can show that they go all the way to the strong coupling regime. We already saw so yesterday the experiment of Professor Townsend showing strong coupling in another system. So here you can also do that. And that's many emitter strong coupling, so the coupling scales like number of molecules or density. However, I now have to remind you that in our Bose condensates we are not in the strong coupling regime. But it's very interesting that it can be achieved in this system. Then we have done a lot of work on lasing, and so have others. So first of all, in plasmonic systems in general, there are many, many lasing works. And then also in this type of arrays, people have shown lasing. So here you see some nice lasing peaks. And we also recently published a work on lasing. And the specialty in our work was that we saw lasing both in the dark and the bright modes of the system. If I go back here, you see this is what we call a bright mode, because we can see it in transmission measurements, and this is the dark one. We can't see it in transmission. But lasing, since it's not dependent on, about coupling from the far field, but you can couple from the molecules, you can also see then, feed the dark mode, and we can see it because we have a finite size array. So both of them lace simultaneously. And then we have recently shown, people have speculated that, okay, everything is very fast in plasmonic system, but we have actually shown in detail that these laser pulses are ultra-fast. And now here, of course, I'm embarrassed to talk about ultra-fast after Ursula Keller's talk, so this is like 3 to 5 orders of magnitude slower, but it's still fast compared to lasers that you can buy or what you can build yourself if you are not Ursula Keller. So, so this shows that the pulses, this is a pump probe study and I will not explain, but basically the experiments we can fit with theory and show that the pulses are typically from 1 to 5 picosecond. And we can also see the build-up time and so on to derive a modulation speed. And we can achieve hundreds of gigahertz, which is quite nice. And there is still a lot to explore more detail, because our simulations of the same lasing behavior show that these plasmonic nanoparticles seem to play quite an important role in the dynamics. So these are FTDT simulations, and we look here at the population inversion. So this is highest inversion, smallest inversion. So right before lasing, we can see that the inversion is highest close to the nanoparticles. So because the fields are very intense there, as Professor Pendry just reminded you about. So we get higher inversion there. And then when the lasing starts, you see here these points immediately deplete. So it seems that the fastest part of the lasing starts close to the nanoparticles. and then afterwards these areas are totally depleted. Would be nice to also more in more detail to see experimentally this type of dynamics close to the nanoparticles, but we so far have like seen the overall dynamics, which is fast. Okay, and one more work about our lasing studies. We also asked that what if we don't have an array, just one dimensional line, and nobody has does this before. And indeed, we can get also that one lasing. And it is this type of dark mode lasing, which you can see here. So these are below threshold, and here it laces. And it doesn't really lace so much in the middle where we have the pump pulse. So from this, you can see where the pump pulse was. This is just fluorescence. So it's dark, but then it propagates along the wire, and it propagates away from the pump spot also. So this might be nice for integration. Okay, so I'm now going to the condensate, and I remind you what was the particle that we want to condense. It's this combination of light and electron plasma oscillations that is this surface lattice resonance. And since there are so many condensates already around, so you can ask, is this, you just go and condense? Well, there is a problem here, that these modes, their lifetimes are only 100 femtoseconds. So first of all, if you want to have some kind of process that puts the particles to the ground state, is it going to be fast enough before everything dies? And second thing is, how are you going to show that you have, for instance, condensation and not lasing when everything happens so fast? There are no obvious methods of monitoring dynamics in this scale. So nevertheless, we did it, and I will show how. But first, some basics. So this you have learned in some course, but let me remind again, what is Bose-Einstein condensation about? It is about bosonic statistics. And bosonic statistics, well, we have a lot of bosons around the photons and some atoms and so on, but they don't necessarily feel these statistics at high temperatures or low densities. So you can also describe them classically. And if you have, for instance, quite high velocities and you are at high temperature, you can describe them like little balls. And you don't need to take into account Bose-Einstein statistics or anything. But then if you cool down, you know that every quantum particle actually has a wave-like nature, and it's characterized by the de Broglie wavelength, which is inversely proportional to temperature. So we all have also our de Broglie wavelength, but it's extremely tiny. But if you take a smaller particle, because it also depends on mass, and cool it down, you will see that this particle is actually a little wave which has an extent in space. And now if you have many of these particles close, or these little wave packets close to each other, it might be that the wave packets start to overlap. So either you have to have very high density or very low temperature or both, and then the quantum wave packets start to overlap. And that will lead to Bose-Einstein condensate. At that moment, they need to follow the Bose-Einstein statistics from which the condensation follows. Okay, so how can we talk about anything like de Broglie wavelength? Because we have excitations that are almost light and they have no mass. Well, they are not totally light. I mean, they have our excitations now, they have this type of dispersion that they follow. So it has here this band edge where you can very locally approximate it, for instance, if you wish, by a parabolic potential, and from that you can get an effective mass. So this is the thing that people do in all of these condensates that are mostly light. they use something, for instance, their cavity, to create a dispersion which displays like something like an effective mass. And then you can calculate that how many of these photons you have to have in the same place that you get a condensate. What is the temperature, what is the density? And and in our case, we do it at room temperature. That's very nice. But we need pretty high densities. So we actually use a femtosecond laser to create big enough densities. Good. So now I come to the system. So we have these nanoparticle arrays, which I already said, having these SLR modes. And then we have above it a liquid that contains dye molecules, this IR792. And then we do the experiment in this way. And this was the essential, the key thing, how we managed to show that we have a condensate here. So we pump the system now here with the femtosecond laser only in one edge of the sample. And we pump it in such a place in the dispersion, maybe I put the dispersion here, that it has momentum. So we pump, let's say, here, which means it starts to propagate along this sample. And then we do measurements along the propagation. So that, of course, whatever happens here, some kind of dynamics, and later position means later time. So in this way, we are turning the distance into time, so to speak, and monitoring the dynamics. So this was very essential. Okay, and here is again the dispersion. I remind you about the band edge. And this energy we can very easily vary. We just change the period of the nanoparticles. We make like many arrays with different periods, and we get the band edge energy at different position. And we have to somehow vary this with respect to the absorption and emission of the molecule. You see the spectra here. And this point where the absorption effectively is zero. I mean, it's zero compared to all losses in the system. So this is very important point. And we vary this with respect to this one. Yeah, so I already mentioned that we somehow have to get the particles to the bottom of the band, even when we pump somewhere here. And the process for that is a kind of thermalization process that has been also applied earlier. And it works like this, that we pump the array on one end. This puts the molecules from the ground state to the excited state. And then they may emit to the dispersion again, but in this emission process, the emitted photon is smaller in energy than the absorbed one, because energy is lost in the vibrations of the molecule. So the molecule has a lot of vibrational states. So in each emission absorption cycle, you also plug in a little bit of energy to the molecule in terms of vibrations. And then once you emit to the mode, the SLR excitation can propagate a little bit, and then it gets absorbed again, emits but loses energy, and so on. So in each cycle you have a photon of a smaller energy. So this thermalization mechanism has been used already in the photon condensates. So let's see, do we see now thermalization, or maybe BC or anything? So we start here from a condition where the band edge is above the position where absorption ends. And we pump in the beginning of the array, and then this propagation and so on starts here. And along the way, what we see is emission to the mode, then absorption, and then emission, but now a little bit of energy was lost in the vibrations. Emission to the band edge, but now we still have some absorption left there, So it gets absorbed, and eventually will I like jump over the band gap and end up in the lower branch. And this is indeed what we see in the experiment. So here at the edge of the array, this is the same axis. We first start emission around the emission maximum, but then along propagation you can see this redshift. Here you are at the band edge, but you can jump over and then here saturate here, and this is how we define this, actually this absorption end. And now we can also, for clarity, integrate the emission around this band edge. It's here, almost nothing is there, just a little bit, but it goes away. And then the rest of the area is this redshifting part, and that is dominating in this process. So in this case, we saw the thermalization, but not much else. Okay, then let's change the condition. Now we match the band edge exactly with the position where the absorption ends. And again, emission, absorption, vibrational relaxation, emission to the band edge, and now there is no absorption left. So this bosonic stimulated emission and bosonic enhancement can take place, and you can condense population in the ground state, and that's how the experiment looks like in this case. Again, you start emission somewhere high energy, and then along propagation you get thermalization, and now at the band edge you accumulate a lot of population. And you can all again follow it, the band edge population, now it starts to grow and it overtakes this population in the other parts of the spectrum. Good, and one more really nice thing in our system is, because you always get this, there is this important question, like how is this different from lasing? And in our system we can also realize lasing and see that it's quite different. And for lasing we put the band edge here well below the absorption end. So basically for the relevant parameters now, we don't have any absorption. So in some sense we have a huge gain from the beginning at the band edge because there is no absorption. And in this case this is what you see. So already from the beginning of the array you get only population at the band edge, so it starts lasing immediately. Good, so from these three cases you see the difference between lasing and condensation in our system, but of course one has to characterize much more. So here are some of the characterizations. First, we wanted to see that does this emission really follow the dispersion, because I have shown only spectra to you, but here I show also the emission as a function of a k vector. And there you can see that if we collect light from here, where the BC is not yet formed, we see that the emission indeed follows this dispersion branch. And now it's only one of them because it propagates one direction. And here, where the BC is ready, then we see everything close to the band edge. Then another thing is you have to now think that, okay, there are these fundamental ingredients that the temperature and the density of the gas or cloud should be such that the wave packets overlap. And this is something that we can calculate, of course, in our system. Of course, it's very, very approximative because, for this effective mass is just a rude approximation in our system. But nevertheless, it gives the right order of magnitude to the position of how dense things should be that we see this condensation. And density is controlled by the pumping laser. The more photons you put in, the denser is your system. And we can see that at some, like these are these three points, around some critical pump fluence, we see the condensate forming. And it's two-dimensional peak in two dimensions in kx and ky. Then we looked at the distribution of the emission around this area where the BEC has formed, and compared also the rate equation simulation, and we can see again the peak appearing when we cross the critical pump fluence, and then when we are above the threshold we fit this distribution to the Bose-Einstein distribution, and that fits very nicely around the room temperature. We expect to be around room temperature because that's where the molecules are. And the rate equation simulation gives very similar behavior, and now here the ratios between the pump fluences here are exactly the same as in the experiment. But then when we look at the lasing distribution, it's totally different, as it should, because laser doesn't have any of this thermal cloud that makes this a little bit smooth here. Instead, you have a very sharp peak, and if we try to fit it with Bose-Einstein Bose-Einstein distribution, it gives extremely small temperature, which means it's wrong. So it's basically a Lorentzian that we, or maybe a Gaussian, but it looks more Lorentzian that we get for lasing, as we should. So there is a very clear difference in the distribution in the lasing and BEC cases. And then to say about this rate equation simulation, this is following the work by Kirton and Keeling, basically the same equation that Professor Keeling yesterday showed. So there is now our plasmonic modes, and then there are the vibrational modes of the molecules and the electronic two-level structure of the molecules, and then the interaction. And we use this derived rate equations, and then we use the experimentally measured absorption and emission profiles there and do the modeling. But if you were maybe accurate, you saw here that in this picture that the rate equation simulation was done in time, and yet we plot like this on top of each other. So of course this is indeed done in time, so there is no spatial dependence of propagation in our rate equation. But we had this hypothesis that along the propagation we can sort of map the distance into time. We can use the fact that we know our dispersion, so there is this group velocity that we know, and we can map what is how fast the propagation happens, and we can map distance into time using the group velocity, and indeed we get from here around 1 picosecond. So the rate equation simulation in time seems to really match qualitatively with the experiment in position. But we were still suspicious about this, that okay, it seems to work, but is it really that everything here happens in 1 picosecond? Because in the end we integrated emission over much longer time than picoseconds, so things could happen slower. So to confirm this really fast dynamics, we also did a pump probe experiment. And quite an unusual one. We had the pump in a different place as the probe. Probe is where the condensate is supposed to form. And how it works, we utilize the non-linearity close to this critical pump fluence. So here things depend very non-linearly on the pump fluence. So if we have negative delays, this means that the probe is here before the pump. What happens is probe creates small population, and that would decay very slowly because it's only spontaneous. So it stays there waiting for the pump photons to come. So overall, you have here now large photon or excitation density, which means you will get output which is around here. So corresponding to this sum of pump plus probe intensities, like this. So that's this higher plateau. But now if you probe arrives later than the pump, much later. So first the pump comes, it creates this condensate, and that will be very quick emission because it's like a lasing pulse. And probe comes later, doesn't know anything about it. So then you would just sum the probe alone contribution with the pump alone contribution, and that amounts to something smaller, which you see here. So where and when this happens, this jump, tells about how long the condensate lives. And indeed, it's in the picosecond scale. So the dynamics is really fast. Then it's very important to look at the coherence properties of a condensate, although in our case, you should not expect true long-range order for many reasons. First of all, we have a finite size condensate because there is a lot of dissipation. So basically, the coherence length of the initial system gives you the size. And long-range order is limited in two-dimensional systems in general, and even more so if you have this kind of driven dissipative system. Still, you should expect order around over distances that are longer than in your system without this condensate. And this is what we see. We did a spatial coherence measurement by using a Michelson interferometer. So basically, collect the emission here and then flip this part on top of this part. And we see interference if both parts are coherent. And this is the image. So you can see how long the fringes extend from this middle line, and from this you get the coherence length, which is about 100 microns, and that is twice the amount that we would have just in the bare SLR mode. And importantly, the coherence, I mean the contrast of the fringes, which is basically the G1, grows when you pump harder, as it should. And finally, I mean this is a nice system to study this lasing BEC crossover. And from theory, it is known that you get a thermalization when you have the case where you have several absorption emission cycles along this thermalization. And this is the case what we have in BC, because we don't have anything here. You see the BC really forms out of those photons that have undergone these cycles, while in the lasing case, in our case, we have immediately a lasing signal. So that's a summary. We have seen a BC in a new system, which is ultra-fast, and we can probe lasing and BC in the same system, and in the future we would like to go, for instance, to the strong coupling regime and these other people. Thank you.